I will say something about our product for the digital instrument cluster with the QT QML optimized. Now, first, let me introduce something about our company, AutoIO. Since 2008, AutoIO has been active China market as a digital instrument cluster engineering service provider. At this time, our application is based on the Qt4 with the Qwidget. We develop a custom plugin for the Qt designer, but the cluster UI is just like a Windows application. It's not a digital dashboard. So from this year's and now, our system is based on the Linux and the Qt 5 later. And thanks for the QML, it can make the modern UI for the instrument cluster. Now, here is the challenge for the cluster. The first one is the user experience. We need a very fast boot. Why? All the electronic in the vehicle must be in a very low power consume when you stop the engine and when you lock your car. So for the cluster consume the current is about 100 nanoampere. The main processor must totally power off. So we must cold boot. The cold boot need very fast. For example, we need a 1 second boot. And the next is the runtime performance. Especially the smooth, the speed, or the RPM, the dashboard, we need about 60 FPS. And the modern UI style and the creative animation is needed. We always think it's not only the electronic product, it's a work of art. As a developer, we must match the OEM factory, the development cycle. So it's the cluster is a long development cycle, but the time is critical. Why? We have to wait for all other electronic component in place until the final validation for a car. The UI change very quickly. We must have a mechanism for the flexibility to apply and change this easy. And the hardware must use the automotive grade IC and with the low cost. Especially in China, low cost is very important. So we must optimize the software for this challenge. Why we use Qt and QML? The first one is reusable and customized for the QML plugin. And it is a scriptable language. So we can change the UI easily. And thanks for the QML compiler. He gives us a very high performance, especially when the system boot. And Yachtel can make it easy to crop the Qt. We can configure the Qt to static link and for boot fast. And we can configure for the Qt in dynamic one for the developer or debug. And here is the component for the automotive cluster that we can extend this based on the QML plugin. The majority UI is developed with the QML. We can change it very quickly. And the 3D engine I will say later. And the high performance controller, this means a special UI for the cluster. For example, the dashboard, the ring of the dashboard, and which is drawn by Qt Thin Graph. We can get the better performance. And the auto weight loader is a special loader, just like the QML loader. But the QML loader is give us a function for asynchronous loading. But the loader provides this mechanism, the loading in a thread priority is the same with the main thread or the thin graph thread priority. That is when the loader is busy, then maybe the UI is blocked. So we need a mechanism to wait some time for the UI animation. It's not it's run the UI animation runs smoothly, especially when the CPU payload is very high. And here is a 3D engine. In 1.5 years later, earlier, sorry, in 1.5 years later, earlier, our customer needs to show 3D car model on the UI. At this time, we use the Qt3D for the demo, Qt3D1 for the demo. But Qt3D cannot work well in Qt 5.4. And the Qt3D2 is still in development, so we have no choice. We must develop a new 3D engine for myself to meet this requirement, our OEM requirements in China. So here is the 3D engine. I will. This is a very light 3D engine based on OpenGL ES2L3. It's only for our requirement from the OEM factory. It can import a 3D model edited in Blender. For example, in Blender, the 3D model, we can import it directly in here, and the material, the texture, the lighting, and even the nodes hierarchical order is keep. It is important the hierarchical order is keep in this engine. For example, we can bind we can bind the door into the car body, and the glass bind into the door. When the car rotation, the glass up and down, the door open and closed. It can in the right place. And another special render effect, such as the headlight, the fog, and the translucent glass is also support in our engine. And here is something about display performance. We must know what is the display performance, what is the bottleneck. I think these three things, the GPU, the memory bandwidth, and the CPU. The CPU, we can monitor it with TOP in Linux, and the first one and two is more important because we have no common method to measure which is the payload. The story is from the bandwidth. I will I will show the bandwidth, how to measure the bandwidth and how to optimize with this bandwidth. And the here is the key technology about multi-layer refresh or multi-frame buffer refresh. We'll give you this method. Now this is the multi-layer refresh with OpenGL. What do this mean? The front end is the real-time rendering, the frequency update. We can, for example, use the meter hands, and about we can update refresh rate with 30 FPS. And behind it, a 3D model car with FBO, we may use 20 FPS. So we can reduce the GPU payload. And we can get more smooth with the RPM and speed. And here is another layer. And here is the final layer. The final display is just like this. And of course, data scalability. With these large displays, people expect to be able to put a lot of data. And it's every single decision that we have to make during the. Now, here is about the memory bandwidth. Now, in our platform, we use the pre-scale IDOMAX 6 with DDR3 bandwidth. What about the DDR3 bandwidth? We can calculate, for example, the DDR3 800. We can calculate the 400 megahertz and multiply to multiply. We use the 32 bit. We get about over 3 gigabytes per second. Is that really the memory bandwidth? No. It's just the pink value. What about this Y? Here is the timing of the DDR3 read, the burst read. You may see a lot of time is here, the time of CAS latency. This is about over 10 nanoseconds. And here is a big second. It's just I copy from it the data sheet. It's for the DDR 800. And if we use N for 8, we get this, about 1.5 gigabytes per second. In actual management, we can get about 1.8 or 2.2 gigabytes per second. It's just the DDR3 / 800 bandwidth. And what about the full screen bandwidth? For example, we use this 1920 multiply 720 with 32 bit with 60 per frequency per second. We can get about over 300 megabytes per second. We call it F. We use the LCD scan from the memory to the LCD panel. We consume F, only one F. The overhead from a full screen 2D display, we read from the original texture and write into the frame buffer and LCD scan. We consume about 3 F. And if we use the GPU texture, this is I measured in the Freescale and Max 6. This is we went GPU, we went GC880. This is a common GPU for the AtomX Solo and AtomX Duolite. We get 5 or 6 times F. Why? I don't know. And maybe someone said this GPU like the L2 cache. Maybe something wrong with the L1 cache. But the result is 5 or 6 times F. This is you can multiply 300. That is the bottleneck. We just only the full screen 5 or the DDR3 bandwidth is just the 6 times F. So the conclusion is we must minimize to use the larger texture. For the regular color or the granted color, use the shader as far as possible. And we can enable the texture compression. We can reduce the texture bandwidth, but it's just a little. I have tested. Here is another method for the frame buffer refresh. We call it a BG image. In this processor, in the Freescale AtomX 6, we can use not only one frame buffer, we can use two frame buffer for the same LCD controller to output on the same LCD. We can use frame buffer 0 for the background and use the frame buffer 1 for the front end. This is we need to enable another frame buffer layer and we add additional F, but we can reduce the background refresh bandwidth about 5 times F. So is this example and I tested it is very effectively. The hardware is Freescale AtomX 6 Duolite, and the DDR we use the 32 bit. The LCD resolution is this, and the measure that we use the MMDC. Here you can get the MMDC. This is not a common software. It's just for the AtomX 6. You can. This is the MMDC result. Measure the memory read and write and the total cycle and calculate about the bandwidth. Here is the result. And we can reduce the front end element as this. Before this method, we get only about 21 FPS. And if we use the two frame buffer, we can get the 60 FPS, and the bus load can even reduce. And here is another application for the BG image. Sorry for the Chinese. Here is an example from the mobile mobile navigation into the instrument cluster. The BG image is the work in another in the frame buffer zero, and the cluster is in the frame buffer one. Sorry for the time. Now I will say something about the fast boot. In recent years, fast boot is a Linux community hotspot. For example, in this year ALS, there are three presentations for the fast boot, and even a BOF about the boot time optimized. And the state of the industry, I think, is about here. In Cortex A level processor, in Linux kernel can boot in about 1 second, and 2 second, 2 seconds in, we can show a 2D interface, and 3 or 5 seconds to complete the entire application layer started with OpenGL and another service. It is easy to from the 20 second to optimize to 3 seconds, but it's hard from the 3 seconds to only 1 second. As a processor and the bus bandwidth performance increase, the time is getting shorter and shorter. Now our result, we can also in the Freescale at Mach 6, we can get 1.2 second, the code boot. Here is the method and the later. The later one is the important I want to say. The one is the parallel loading, and another is we can use a double root file system. The small one we call the initfs. It called is from the fast boot UI, the Qt application with static link. And another is the normal Linux root file system for service. The key, of course, is hardware accelerated. Here is our platform. The boot device is eMMC. We can read it about this speed. And the software is Linux and Qt and initfs. It uses the static links. Qt app and with the Chinese font, with about the size is 27 megabit. The time measurement tool is grab serial, and here is normal boot result. They use the EXT4 initfs. We spent a lot of time mount and with Qt startup. And we use the RAMFS. That is the bootloader can load all the init FS into the memory and start Qt. We just spent a little time. Yes. And here is the final version. We can load it in another CPU core. We can, when the bootloader start up, we can use SMP boot. We call the SMP boot. We can load this initfs into RAM in another core. And we can speed up, save about more than 500 millisecond. This is the final. No, here is the conclusion. Qt is a good choice for the digital. Yeah.
It's okay.
Yeah. That's okay. Thank you.
Thank you, Lou. I think we need 10 more minutes at least. Thank you. So are there any questions? We are a little over on the time, so maybe quick. Yes.
Sorry for my poor English. You can speak slowly.
You're fine. You're fine. Thank you. You mentioned textures and texture loading taking time. By textures, are you referring to PNGs, for example? Image files, or?
If you use the PNG texture load into the memory, and we can, I think we can extreme it into the GPU local format. I don't know.
Thank you.